Everyone, for today's webinar session. Today is the sixth webinar session of this webinar series. I hope you are all familiar with the do's and don'ts of this webinar. Still, I will go through them very briefly. Please, everybody, remember to keep yourself muted throughout the session. And the Q&A session will be held, as Abhishek sir said, 15 minutes or 15 minutes after the session. And therefore, many of us were complaining that the hand raise option is not there in the Microsoft Teams window. So if you do not find the hand raise option, please feel free to unmute yourself and ask. Okay, so Mr. Abhishek, over to yourself. Please give a short introduction.
Thank you, Ishika. I have the toughest job this morning because I have a very short time to introduce someone whom I could spend a long time talking about. So it is my pleasure to welcome Dr. Ranjit Shah, my senior, my teacher, to this session. He received his MSc Tech in geophysics in 1987 and then subsequently went on to do a PhD and receive it in 1990 from ISM. He then went on to have an illustrious career teaching the likes of us as a faculty member at the department until the year 2007, where ISM's loss was the industry's gain, where he joined Fugro Jason, and from then on has gone strength to strength to lead the data consultancy services at Schlumberger for reservoir characterization, and currently is the regional technical manager for the entire eastern region of CGG. He's an active member of SEG and AACG and a life member of SPG, AEG and IGU. And above everything, what we hold dearly is he's a great teacher. So I'm glad that you've got some time to spend with him. Over to you, sir.
Good morning, my young friends. Good morning, Abhishek, Ipsita. Good morning, everyone present today. Getting connected to Indian School of Mines is always very close to heart. So I should thank everyone for giving me this opportunity. Indeed, very glad. Today I shall talk about something which is very close to my heart again. Seismic inversion for reservoir characterization. If you ask me what I have done in my career, possibly the answer will come inversion. That is practically the entire career of mine has been spent on this particular topic, whether it is a theoretical development or practical applications. But that is a different subject altogether. Today, what we shall talk about that how seismic inversion is used for reservoir characterizations. When I was giving a final touch today, I was asking myself, did I put the right title over there? Reservoir, what type of reservoir I am talking about? Am I talking about water reservoir, the lakes, the ponds, the wells and others which are available? And if I am talking about those reservoirs, do I need seismic to delineate them? Of course not. I am talking about subsurface reservoir and those reservoir which contain hydrocarbon, either in the form of a gas or in the form of a liquid. I am talking about seismics. Now, being at Dhanbad, did you anytime wonder that why seismics is not that popular in the mining industry? But whenever we talk about oil and gas, whether it's in explorations, development, and other, if you remove seismics, can you do it? The answer lies somewhere there. But what is the other options for characterizations of the reservoir? Naturally, drilling. And since mining industry deals with depths which are not great, you can have got quite a dense drilling, a strategy of drilling, which can be very, very large in number. Cost is not prohibitive. So you can delineate most of the mineral industry, whether it is any kind of mineral, coal and others, they rely on that. Put the same thing for oil and gas industry. It will not be that easy. the shallow wells, or those particular gas or well reservoirs which are quite shallow are no longer there. We have got much deeper and deeper targets. We have got much complex, more and more complex targets. And for their characterizations, completely knowing about that, you need much to do beyond simply go on wildcat drilling. And that is where comes the role of seismics. And we shall talk about not only seismics, we shall talk about seismics in person as such. So for about 1 hour, I shall talk about what is seismics inversion, what are the different types of seismics inversion, like two major categories of seismics inversion, like deterministic inversion, as well as geostatistical inversions. You can consider geostatistical inversion to be stochastic inversion. So deterministic inversion and stochastic inversion. Geostatistical inversions is only a special type of stochastic inversion. And we shall talk about seismic inversions, and I shall take a kind of a pictorial tour. There are a lot many applications. In fact, you talk of anything in seismics, anything in the oil and gas reservoir, there will be application of seismics, and there will be applications of seismic inversions. So very quickly, we shall take a pictorial tour. Summary and discussions, I have put all together a different topic so that we can spend quite a lot of time, 20 minutes to half an hour, and if required, even more than that. Let's first talk about what is seismic inversion and what is its role in reservoir characterizations. And I said that when I say reservoir characterization, it is subsurface reservoir characterizations as well as it is characterizations for oil and gas, or in one word, hydrocarbon. Just I have taken this definition from very well-known sources, Encyclopedic Dictionary of Applied Geophysics by Sarif. All of you know it very well, and you are using. I am using Wikipedia, and I am using Oilfield Glossary, so that these definitions are not mine. You need not, in fact, since this material will be available to you, you can read it later. What are the key words over there? That seismic inversion is practically converting interface properties to layer properties. Seismic inversion is all about integrations of multidisciplinary data, not only seismics, interpretations of the seismic data, well logs, interpretations of the well logs, cores, and many other things. So all different kinds of multidisciplinary data available in the oil and gas industry, they can be very judiciously integrated in seismic inversion. Now these integrations in deterministic inversion will be up to certain level, whereas when you go to geostatistical inversion, these integrations will be really a very, very strong integrations of multidisciplinary data. Dictionary says that inversion is all about determining the cause from the observed effect. What has caused the seismic data or any other data which I have observed in the surface? This is the subsurface, properties of the subsurface. Elastic property give rise to seismic data. Resistivity will give rise to resistivity data, or magnetotelluric or any other electrical methods you talk about. Those are the effects. And from those effects, we shall determine the cause. What has caused that? And that is solutions of the inverse problem. And today we shall talk about not all the inverse problems, rather we shall talk about the seismic inversions only. Oilfield Glossary says data to model. I have got so many different kinds of data on the subsurface, some in the subsurface, but what is the model? I need to have got a model which is predictive. I should have got knowledge of the subsurface which I will be able to use to exploit hydrocarbon. I will be able to bring hydrocarbon which are lying at a much depth to the surface. I will be able to produce that. And that productions, because it will be dynamic in nature, my reservoir model should be a predictive model. Where I should put the other wells? Where I should put infill wells? So all these questions should be answered from a model which is a common model or detailed subsurface model. And there are other alternate definitions of seismic inversions. I am not going into that. Reservoir characterizations. When we talk about reservoir, we talk about the physical properties, the porosity, permeability, fluid saturations, and others. In fact, permeability has been written about twice. Volume of the clay, that means whether what type of lithology it is. So this is kind of subjects or objects what we like to determine from reservoir characterization. A reservoir characterization is a study in the part of development of a reservoir model. That is how PetroWiki did. So these two things together, one is reservoir, characterizations of the reservoir, and other is the how seismic inversions can be used for that. Now I shall connect this particular figure with what Abhishek told on day number one, that where has seismic applications in the life cycle of a reservoir, in explorations to productions to even abandonment, which I have not put over there. Seismic can be put in prospective evaluations. It can be used in explorations. In fact, seismic is the major tool which has been used in explorations, in appraisal, in development, in productions, in secondary recovery, and also in abandonment of the field. So there are lot of different kinds of applications of seismics, and wherever there is in seismics, seismic inversions also plays an important role. Just now I was talking about a reservoir model, and I said that reservoir model has to be predictive. What kind of predictions it can do? You can see the list: reliable estimate of gross rock volumes, initial hydrocarbon in place, that is prospective evaluation. It will be used in assessment of the risk, whether the well I want to drill that will come right, or it may, there are risk of becoming a dry well. So that is kind of a risk assessment, as well as for portfolio management, optimizing the number of the wells. The field is in development stage, so how seismic inversions will help to find out how many wells have to be located for a optimal productions of that. Bypass potential, already the field is producing, but then there are areas where from the well or gas has not come. The drawdown is not from that particular area. Seismic inversion, specifically called time lapse or 4D seismics, will help you to find out that where these well or gas are hiding, which have not been drawn yet. There are more applications like static and dynamic modeling using the seismic inversion data. If you look into the right figure, you will find that seismic data integrated with well data, petrophysics, rock physics, structural interpretation, all these can be combined for reservoir characterizations. And reservoir characterizations, you can see, though it is mostly used at the appraisal and development and production stage, it has got applications also in exploration as well as in the advanced stage of the production. Now, coming back again to the definitions of seismic inversion, I said that seismic inversion is from interface property to layer property. What does it mean? If you think carefully, seismic is a band limited signal. Since it does not have got the low frequency, it does not have got the high frequency, what it can do, it simply can give you information about where there is a change in the elastic properties. If I talk about P impedance or acoustic impedance, it can only talk about all those places where the acoustic impedance has changed. It will not give you information about the layers. And we want the information about the layers, because when I want to relate acoustic impedance with the porosity, acoustic impedance with volume of clay, acoustic impedance with water saturation, I am not looking at the interface which separates a shale from a sand. Rather, I want to find out what is the porosity of the sand layer. So I need to know porosity or acoustic impedance of that particular sand layer. And that is what I am talking about, that that is a layer property, that is not property of the interface. So seismic inversion has, this is one of the biggest role to play, that it converts interface property to layer property. And how does it do it? It requires quite a bit of integrations, and let me say that it is integrations of the well logs, and with the seismic data and the geological informations, it can perform that particular task. Next, let's talk about that. What are the reservoir properties we are talking about, or what could be a very simple model of seismic inversion? At the top figure, you see that I have got the earth. Earth has got different layers, different rocks. Each rock has got a characteristics, elastic properties. I do a seismic experiment, which is shown by the wavelet over there, and I get observed seismic data. That seismic data acquired, processed, and now ready, either in terms of full stacks or in terms of the angle stacks. So where it is written theta, it is an angle stacks. Where theta is not written, it is a full stacks. And you know what is the model for seismics. Reflectivity converted with wavelet, added with random noise, that is what is seismic data, whether full stacks or angle stacks. Now, given the seismic data, which is the effect, I want to get back to the layers. I want to know what are the rocks, whether it is a sand, it is a shale, it is a limestone or something else, and what are the different properties. So practically then, in seismic inversion, I am starting with the seismics and undoing the effect of the wavelet. That is the keyword. What wavelet has done to the subsurface, I have undoing, I am practically trying to undo that one. And once I undo, what I shall get? I will get elastic properties. Still, I will not get back the rocks. Rock properties, I shall get elastic properties of the rock, not the reservoir properties which I am interested in. So to get that particular reservoir properties, again, those elastic properties, whether it is acoustic impedance, shear impedance, density, or any else, they need to be converted under certain understanding. And that understanding needs a relationship between petrophysical properties and then elastic properties, and we shall call that to be a rock physics. Just to be brief, if I am talking about acoustic impedance or the P impedance, it is function of lithology, it is function of porosity, fluid content, depth, pressure, others. One more thing, in reservoir calculations, we shall like to know that how the reservoir is distributed, what is its geometry, what is the connectivity of the reservoir, and seismic inversions will help us quite a bit on that one. So just kind of what I can get from the well logs. From the well logs, I have got many routine types of logs like gamma ray, SP, neutron density, resistivity, acoustic, sonic, etc. Many different elastic properties of the rocks at the wells can be computed. P impedance, S impedance, ratio of VP and VS, that is P velocity, S velocity ratio, Poisson's ratio, lambda rho, mu rho, etc. Whereas from seismics, I will not be able to get gamma ray, I will not be able to get SP. From seismics, I will be able to determine only elastic properties, and those elastic properties will be acoustic impedance, shear impedance, BPBS, and then derivatives of that. And besides that, what I have not written is the density, because density is not as such a elastic property, it is a physical property. So from wells and seismics, what are the common? You can see the common things are all the elastic properties, and that is what will be practically the link. And as I said, the rock physics will be the link between that. So within reservoir properties, it would be volume of clay, porosity, water saturations, even permeability can be determined in some situations, but then I deliberately did not write because it is not that easy to determine. Talking about seismic methods, in fact, there are many different methods of seismic inversion methods practically. In the blue box, you can find I have written about the attributes, which are amplitude attributes, and ABO or ABA, which are amplitude variations with offsets and azimuth. Those are not really inversion methods, but I have written that because those are precursors of inversion. Unless seismic attribute, ABO and ABA, these methods have not been matured, then seismic inversion would not have been that popular as it is today. On the below box, you can see the colored box, all the different methods of inversions are written like recursive inversion, colored inversion, sparse-specific inversion, model-based inversion, more simultaneous inversion, geostatical inversions, and nowadays we are talking about sparse layer inversion too. But look at the right side, just on the green box and below, all these methods can be broadly divided into two. One is deterministic inversion and the stochastic inversion. In fact, instead of stochastic inversions, I am writing geostatical inversion because industry knows stochastic inversion better by geostatical inversion. Within the box, I have written one more thing, which is uncertainty quantifications, and we shall have got a full topic on that one, we shall deal in detail. Other than that, whether it is a deterministic inversion or geostatical inversion, if you have got a time-lapse data, this will be 4D inversion. It can be multi-component inversions, it can be azimuthal inversions, and now are the days for full azimuth, full waveform inversion, which is practically the current research. I will not go into so much of detail of many of the methods, rather I shall focus on deterministic inversion and geostatical inversion, which are very routinely used in the industry. I shall make certain assumptions over there. In my examples, all the time I shall talk about sand and shale. I shall assume that we are in a very shale war part where the sands are very loose sands. Shale has got higher acoustic impedance compared to sands. So that is simply an assumption to make all these analysis and talking easier. It does not mean that sands have got always higher, lower acoustic impedance than the shale. In fact, depending upon which part it is, what geological conditions, what is the depositional environment and others, there can be many of the varieties. But whenever I am talking about the examples of sand and shale, I shall make that particular assumption. Moving forwards, let's talk about that how seismic inversions can be broadly categorized. They can be categorized first as trace-based and the other as model-based. Trace-based, that starts with seismics. Model-based starts with a background model or an initial model. So in a trace-based inversions, you take the seismics, deconvolve the wavelet, so you get a reflectivity. That reflectivity, you integrate, then you get impedances and do it in an iterations so that the synthetic and seismics matches, and when you consider that the match is acceptable, that becomes the subsurface property. Whereas in a model-based inversion, you start with an earth model. Let me say, model for acoustic impedance. How can I generate? I have got the wells, few of the wells. Those well acoustic impedance, I can interpolate according to a structural framework compliant with that. I take a low frequency from that one, which can act as a model, initial model. And then I use an inversion scheme, which can be very rudimentary type of inversion scheme. Still, I will be able to compute the synthetic, and I shall go on perturbing those particular model until I have got a good match of the seismics and the synthetic. So category-wise, there are two things. One is the trace-based driven by seismics, and other is model-based starting from the model. I will not say driven by model. It is starting by model. Still, it is driven by the seismics. So if I talk about the trace-based one, these are the methods. Recursive, a very old method. It integrates traces from the surface value without generating. In fact, it generates one reflection point per sample. No wavelet is required. So there are merits. No wavelet required, it becomes simple. But demerits, that wavelet still remains in that one. So there is no detuning. Sparse spike method is one very, very commonly used inversion technique in the industry. It models the seismic data with minimum number of reflection coefficients. And if you look into what is the philosophy of this is Occam inversion. I could find that Occam inversion is in your course. You will learn quite in detail in that, but that relies on a very simple philosophy. Some around 250 years or 300 years back, William of Occam, a clergy as well as I will say economist and scientist, he proposed, which I can put in a very simple sentence. Why use more if it can be done with less? That means why unnecessarily complicate if something can be explained with simplicity? And subsurface can be very simply represented by spikes. Spikes are the points where there is reflection. And those reflections are not very large in number. So when you try to explain the seismics, don't complicate it. Minimize the number of spikes, number of the reflections coefficient, which can explain you data. And that is the philosophy of sparse spike inversion. We shall see in details. Model-based inversion. There are deterministic inversions which can be model-based. There are geostatical inversions which are always a model-based inversion. As I said, model-based inversions will require an initial model which will be perturbed to better fit the seismic data. And these results are constrained on the initial model. Geostatistical, they additionally include statistical relationships to constrain that. And this statistical relationship is very, very important. We shall see later on that when we do deterministic inversion, we have got certain limitations. Those limitations can be surmounted or those can be solved only when I bring into geostatistics into the picture. Different types of inversion. You need not read everything. Those highlighted by blue are the most important part. If I am using a full stack data, then I will get acoustic impedance. If I am using multiple stack or pre-stack data, then results of inversions will be P impedance, BPBS and density. But what happens in deterministic inversion? One full stack data, one acoustic impedance. One set of multiple stack data, one set of P impedance, BPBS and density. The same thing changes. When I go to geostatical inversion, even with one full stack data, I will have got multiple realizations of P impedance because it talks about different realizations. We will talk about probability, right? So probability and uncertainty analysis will be integral part of geostatical inversion. Again, if it is a single stack, I will get acoustic impedance. If it is a multiple stacks of pre-stack, we can get P impedance, BPBS and density. Deterministic, only one volume for each property. Geostatistical, multiple realizations for each of the property. How many? I cannot say. It can be 10, 20, 50, 100, depending upon how many you require to characterize your reservoir and what is your capability, means computational capability. In one slide, I can put this as a summary. Single stack inversion, whether full stack, angle stack, or offset stacks, or multiple partial stacks. This is the summary slide. What you need to remember for anything in the future, like interview other, this particular slide, that what are the different kinds of the inversions available. Now we shall go a bit deep into deterministic inversion, and I should say that deterministic inversion is very, very popular. In fact, all the applications in industry, if I put together, then it will be 80% of 75 to 80% of deterministic inversion and rest of geostatical inversion. There are many different types of deterministic inversion. Very simple one is a trace integration. It is one of the earliest type of inversion. And look into the simplicity of the first equation. Reflection coefficients, they can be written as a differential of logarithm of acoustic impedance. That means this relationship between acoustic impedance and reflectivity is a kind of a integration and differentiation. So if I want to find out the acoustic impedance from reflectivity, what I need to do? I need to simply integrate that, integrate the reflectivity. And how can I determine the reflectivity? Seismic data, deconvolve the wavelet, then you get reflectivity, and then simply integrate and exponentiate, you get trace integration. It is a very simple method, and as I said, that one of the earliest method, but it is not a kind of a rudimentary method, not that much in use nowadays, unless some interpreter uses it. Next one is recursive inversion. And this relies on a very simple relationship again, our definitions of the reflectivity. Look into this particular part, that if you remember resistivity method, Picard's relationship, how you can determine all the layers, resistive layers, starting from the basement or the bottom layer, knowing the reflection coefficients of that, exactly the same relationship. Or in magnetohydraulic method, if you have studied the layer stripping method of interpretation, then recursive inversion is something like that. Find out the reflectivities, and if you know the reflectivity of the top surface, then starting from the top surface, you can go on recursion and find out the impedances. The whole problem is that they are quite okay in the seismic band, which is a band limited. Still, they cannot fill up the low frequency. And as I said, that seismic dynet have got low frequency. Dynet have got the high frequency problem. We shall discuss it later. Let us first talk about all the different methods. Colored inversion is a very, very, very innovative concept. Think of a well. At a particular location, I have got a well, I have got a seismic data. And even though well is in depth, I know some relationship by which I can convert into time. So well is also in. So I was talking about how we can view about colored inversion. So in colored inversion, let us think something like that I have got a well, at one location I have got well and seismics. And this HT, what I have written, is the earth response. So if I can find out earth response, then given the seismics, I can convert it into the impedances. So finding out the earth response is not very difficult, because at the well locations, I know both the acoustic impedance measured at the well as well as the seismic data. So it depends on that particular principle. And again, I will say that it is one of early methods, is still in use, but not that extensively used as it was used, let me say, 15, 20 years ago. Elastic impedance is a very innovative concept. Why innovative? So in this case, you can see that acoustic impedance, the definitions of the acoustic impedance as a product of density and P impedance, that can be extended. Acoustic impedance, I can also consider that within acoustic impedance, Vs is there. Only thing is that its power equal to zero. Now, if I look into angle dependent data, if I look into AVO, where the reflectivity is a function of theta. So this is the expression. This is the expressions of angle dependent reflectivity, R theta like that, in terms of density reflectivity, P reflectivity, as well as S reflectivity. So I can extend the concept of acoustic impedance to include elastic impedance, and that can be written in this particular form. So elastic impedance and its other variant, also called extended elastic impedance, which I am not talking in today's lecture, is quite popular. Next, the two methods which are very, very popular in industry, sparse spike inversion and model-based inversion. This is sparse spike inversions. I already talked about that. That what is the principle behind it. Principle behind it is the Occam's inversion, a great philosophy. So you consider that the earth subsurface or can be explained so far as the seismic data is concerned with less number of spikes or less number of reflection coefficient. So you take seismic data, you take log data, you take all the horizon data, means interpretations, create a model, extract the wavelet, and use low frequency as a control. So all these things together, you can find out an inversion, which is called spike inversion. Model-based inversion, looking into the theory, all those mathematics, you may get a bit scared, nothing to get scared about it. If you look into that middle one, where I have written d observed is equal to function of m initial and something like that plus plus, you can very easily identify, what did I do? I simply make a Taylor series expansion. So with such a simple concepts of mathematics, I will be able to find out, given the data d, I can find out the perturbations in the model which is required to explain this particular data. So in a summary, I will say that you start with a model, initial model, then go on perturbing that particular model and keep on computing the synthetic and do it until the synthetic matches with the seismics, means observed seismics. And when the observed seismics and synthetic matches, that model we consider to be the final model of the subsurface. Now, let's talk about simultaneous inversion. I am talking about simultaneous inversion because it is more general than full stack inversion. In simultaneous inversions, what you require? You require multiple offset stacks or angle stacks. If you are using offset stacks, you will require seismic velocity for conversion into angles, because you know very well that the reflectivity equations is in angles, not in offset. What are the weld measurement required? Those are P sonic or P velocity, S sonic or S velocity, and density. You will also require interpretations of horizontal faults, which Abhishek has already discussed quite in details. And then seismic partial angle stacks, how many? Minimum three. You know the answer, because there are three properties which are to be determined: acoustic impedance, shear impedance or BPPS, density, and any of their derivative. So these are the requirements. Have seismic angle stacks, well log data, horizon interpretations. Then you will do some analysis. You will do well tie and seismics. Why this is required? Because seismics is in time and well is in depth. So depth data need to be brought into time before you start integrating. So well tie, determine the wavelet. Other than that, since you have got the well and the interpretations, you would compute the or create the low frequency model. Low frequency model is a very, very important thing. And then use that in the inversion engine. Here it is written multi-stack inversion. It can be model based, it can be sparse spike, or it can be anything else. And then you get the property volumes, the acoustic impedance, BPBS, density, and like that. And once those are there, you will be able to interpret again on the basis of the rock physics relationship, which we have established, into different geo bodies, like where the sands are, if the sands are there, whether they are filled with hydrocarbon or they are brine, where other sweet spots are there, you will be able to determine, or that is what we call interpretation. So in this one, as you can see that what are the very, very important thing in seismic inversion? One is that you should have got the right wavelet. Unless you have got the right wavelet, whatever sophisticated inversion you have, that may be wrong. So wavelet estimations is very, very important. And as I said, wavelet estimations is a kind of if you try to relate with earthquake seismology, then it is like finding out the focus of the earthquake. So many of the things you need to know, some of the things are very, very unknown. So wells which are available in depth, you need to bring in time, seismics is there. You need an initial time depth relationships, which can come from VSP, which can come from check shot data. And that's why we wanted this borehole seismics to be, webinar to be before seismics inversion, because all those borehole informations will also be integrated in seismics inversion. Once you have done that, then you estimate a wavelet. There are good methods. There are many methods of estimation of the wavelet, but I shall talk about that. What is a good wavelet? The properties of a good wavelet, that the envelope is centered at the zero. There are not higher order side lobes. Side lobes should be there, but those side lobes should be, that should taper up to zero, and then it should have got smooth amplitude spectrum. There should not be notch in the amplitude spectrum. So these are the characteristics of the, and the next one, the phase spectrum should be flat. It need not be, it can be linear, but it cannot oscillate. So within the seismic band, these are the characteristics of a wavelet. Next important one is a low frequency model building. In fact, low frequency model building in seismic inversion is one very gray area. It is the weakest link of seismic inversion. If you ask me that when I do seismic inversion, where is my confidence very second, very shaky, it is the low frequency model building. We work in dark. We do not know what is there in the subsurface. Seismic dynamics have got the low frequency. Who has got the low frequency? It is the wells. Wells are not, they are plenty in number. If there are very high number of wells, maybe people will not go for seismic inversion. So these are some of the things which need to be taken into concern. Of course, seismics has got low frequency, not in amplitude, in seismic velocity. But even though seismic velocity have got a low frequency information, it is not more than 2 hertz or 3 hertz. I am not talking about very modern day seismics where this can be much more. I am talking about the legacy seismics. So that dynamics have got the low frequency. And not having low frequency has got very big impact. So this curve or this particular cartoon, you can see what you have got in the well. Wells have got all the frequencies. This magenta curve, you can see, starting from zero to very large frequencies, everything is available in the well. The blue curve, which is shaded, that is seismics, it does not have got the high frequency, it does not have got the low frequency, it is a bandpass signal, band-limited signal. What is the impact of not having high frequencies? High frequencies not there means the resolutions of bed will be less. You might have already read that. How thin is a thin bed? And what is the rule of the thumb? Quarter of a wavelength. And quarter of a wavelength is quite a large thickness. On the other hand, not having the low frequency has got much bigger impact. We will not be able to interpret. We will not be able to interpret the data. If you do not have got the low frequency, even acoustic impedance will look like a seismic data. Look at this particular cartoon where black gives the original acoustic impedance. Blue gives the low frequency and the red one is the low frequency removed. So if low frequency is removed and then my bandpass signal also have got positive and negative, that is not better than the seismic. So this is very, very important. Come over there, just look into that I have got a particular well put in a time. Those high oscillations you can see, those are the acoustic impedance from the well, which has got a very high frequency. You can determine it is so high that it is available up to Nyquist. In fact, whatever is the sampling rate, it is available up to Nyquist. Now, look at the red one, the trend, maximum 2 hertz, though I have written 3 hertz, but it does not have more than 2 to 3 hertz, right? So it is a very, very low frequency trend over there. And that need to be given from outside. Then green curve is practically the low frequency, which seismic lacks. Which seismic velocity does not have got? Seismic velocity has got very trend one like the red. So I can get that from seismics. But from, let me say, 2 to 10 hertz or 2 to 6 hertz, which is not available in seismics, I do not have got any way to find out. That green curve is that one. And it has got quite a big impact. And what is the low frequency blue curve you see over there? That is what you can bring from seismics. So what is coming from seismics, what is coming from low frequency, it can go up to 60 hertz. In this particular example, there can be situation depending upon what is the maximum frequency available in the seismic data, it can be much lesser. It can be 30 hertz even, right? So the whole point is that low frequency model building is very, very important and it is very, very challenging. Sometime one of my friends asked me a question that how confident you are about your low frequency. Since he was a friend, I could cut a joke and I said, that my low frequency model is correct till you drill the next well. Could you find out the meaning of that one? I said that I am not able to say that. If you drill a well, I can confidently say that in the bandpass, which is bringing by seismics, I can say that yes, I am right. But low frequency, depending upon situations, it can be right. It can be completely wrong too. So low frequency model building, one need to put quite a good amount of innovative effort. And there are many different kinds of workflows of low frequency model building. I shall talk about the traditional one, as I said, that where from the information will come. 0 to 2 hertz will come from seismic velocity. 2 hertz to whatever is lacking, whether 6 hertz or 10 hertz, that will come from the wells. But since wells are not plenty in number, that will be interpolated. That will not be interpolated, it will not be a blind interpolation, it will be interpolated, guided by the horizons and faults as you see in the diagram. At the top, that is the structural framework, and at the bottom that acoustic impedance or CR impedance and density which has been propagated and high cut filtered to 6 Hz. In this particular case, you can see a low frequency will look like that. For model based inversion, this will be a starting point, whereas for pulse spike inversion, this will not be starting point. We shall start from seismics, but later on we shall add that one. If I don't use the low frequency part, then inversion component will be called bandpass impedance or bandpass inversion, or it will be called relative inversion. Whereas when I add that with the low frequency, then it will be called a absolute result or full band result. So these are the nomenclature. As I said, these are the traditional methods. There are much more methods. Traditional method also have got their own problem. In fact, that can be quite biased as well. Now let's talk about the interpretation. And I said that rock physics is a tool for interpretation. Rock physics help us quite a lot. By simple way, how you can understand rock physics, as I said, that it is practically the interrelationship between the petrophysical data, like volume of clay, porosity, and water saturation, and with the elastic data, which I can determine from the seismic inversion, like impedance, acoustic impedance, shear impedance, or BPVS and density. And let's look into that one. That first I need to understand that in my area, what is the relationship? This is an example only. And it is a cross plot of P impedance and BPVS, color coded or plotted with color as volume of clay, porosity, water saturation. And you can see very different kinds of trends. These trends may vary. General trend will remain one and the same, but then for a particular field, there can be some minor variation. And this understanding will help me to interpret data. If volume of clay increases, means the quality of the sand becomes poor, then what happens? Look at this particular one, the one which has been put as a porosity, the top right. Porosity increases, same sand, porosity increases. What will happen? P impedance will decrease, whereas BPVS will increase. If I have got water saturation, the bottom one, left panel, if you see that sand, whether it is a brine field or gas field, the same seed, sand, if it is gas field, then it will have got much lower acoustic impedance and BPVS compared to the brine field one. So this gives us a framework for interpretation. I can also have got kind of a scenario modeling, especially for 4D studies, it is very, very important. So what are the effect of the pressure change? How does pressure change the impedances, P impedance, S impedance? So you can have got this particular understanding before going for interpretation. So rock physics has got quite a big role. Rock physics is a new subject. It is a very, very fast developing subject. And I will consider that many of you may become specialized rock physicists in the coming days. Once I have got that one, how do I interpret? It is a very simple example. I am not talking about P impedance and BPVS together. Just for simplicity, I am talking about P impedance. Here you can see that I can find out that this P impedance on the x-axis, high P impedance are shale, and low P impedance, they are sand. Even within the low P impedance, you can see that high P impedance, this can be sand or shale, but low impedance are all P sands. So if I put a kind of a threshold of around 1400 something or 14,000 something, then below that all are P sands. So now I have got seismic inversion. So if I have got seismic inversion, then anything below that one, I will be able to capture a P sand. That is how it works. So shown in wells, so if I use that particular threshold, first I shall see that whether this particular threshold captures all my P sands properly in the wells. If it captures properly in the well, then from the seismic inversion, I shall use exactly the same scheme for mapping the P sands. Next, let's talk about the uncertainty. There is uncertainty everywhere. No model is correct. There is no single model exists which accurately captures all information. That's why it is very, very important to capture the uncertainty. Uncertainty has got two components. One is the natural variability. There is inherent randomness in the processes. And there is another variability which is called bias, has got against several components. Knowledge uncertainty, knowledge inadequacy, inaccuracy in the data, which are the errors, and assumption and simplifications in the theoretical model which use. And all these are present in all the data, all geophysical data which we acquire. So this can be captured in, or rather this should be captured. There is not a direct way to capture this in deterministic inversion, but in geostatical inversion, uncertainty quantification is an integral part, right? So let's first see that how do we do in deterministic inversion. Let me talk about the same type of scenario that I have got acoustic impedance. And in this particular case, you can see at the middle panel where I have got from the histograms, the green curves, they are the patients, the blue is the brine sand, and red is the cell, right? And here I want to capture all the patients, all the green. So if I take on the left panel, middle left, if I take a threshold somewhere around 17,000, the green curve, then you can see that you are capturing everything. You are capturing the patient, you are capturing the brine sands, you are capturing the cell. That means there is a lot of misinterpretation. Even brine sands are captured as a patient. On the other hand, if I don't like to capture any of the brine sands, I take a threshold, which is middle panel, right one, the green line, then I am not capturing my patients totally. Lot of patients have been missed. That means the truth will lie somewhere here, and that truth will be hedgy. It will not be that I need to talk in terms of probability, because in between these two different situations, there is a lot of overlap. What I say as patient may be patient, may not be patient. And once I say may be or may not be, I started talking about the probability. And Bayesian theory or Bayesian inference, that gives you a framework to do that. Before the experiment is a prior. I know certain things before the seismic inversion. And after seismic inversions, that knowledge is updated. So that is known as posterior. So this posterior knowledge will be coming in terms of the probability, and I can determine facies or lithology probability, as you can see in the top one, that would be the most probable facies. What is most probable? Out of, I was talking about three facies, the brine, the patient, as well as the well sand over there. Out of these, which has got highest possibility or probability at a particular point, that is the most probable facies. And below, what is the probability of that? So these things taken together can be interpreted in a very nice way. Look at the right curve. So I have got a map of the probability of the well sand. So where, if I have to drill the next well, I know where to drill. I shall drill a well where the probability is very high, where the most probable facies is well sand with a high probability. Those are the places where I am going to drill my next well, whether those are infill wells or those are other production swell, or even any different purposes. Even if it is an exploration swell where there is nothing, I will rely on that. So that is all about deterministic inversions in a very, very brief way. Now let us talk about the other inversion technique, which is geostatistical inversion. And it will be very, very introductions only. Geostatistical inversion is a very vast subject. I will not be able to do quite a justice with that in 5 or 10 minutes of time, but I shall try to do that.
50 minutes.
What are the limitations? Yeah, I could see that. So what are the limitations of this? Deterministic inversion has got a limitation that it does not bring you any information above the seismic band. So nowadays, we are talking about very thin sands, which are below seismic resolutions. So how can we bring that? Geostatistical inversion provides a framework. So look at this particular one. The top panel is a seismic, middle is deterministic inversion, and below is a geostatistical inversion. And you can see much details of the subsurface using geostatistical inversions. And on the right panel, you can see the frequency content. Seismic has got certain frequency content. Deterministic inversion has got more or less similar, a bit better. But once you go for geostatistical inversions, you have got much higher frequency content. And as I informed or as I discussed, that it is the frequency which determines the resolutions. Higher and higher frequency, better and better resolutions, and you will be able to map thinner and thinner bands. So geostatistical inversion, the philosophy is that you recognize that all input information, what you are using, whether these are measured well data, seismic velocity, petrophysics, horizon interpretation, stratigraphy, or your models and hypotheses, all have got certain uncertainties, and phrase them in terms of the probability and generate multiple realizations. And all those multiple realizations will honor all input information, whether it is a data, belief, or hypothesis, and they will reflect multiple sources of uncertainty. So for any geostatistical inversion, there will be three components. The first is geostatistical modeling. What is the difference between normal statistics and geostatistics? In statistics, the order of the data is not important. In geostatistics, in order of this data is important. Means their spatial relationships is very, very important. We will talk about the correlation as well as the variograms. Those are practically some of the statistical measure which determine or depend upon the spatial relationship. So three component: geostatistical modeling, Bayesian inference, and sampling of the posterior probability density functions. And look at this cartoon. This cartoon is very, very simple and important. All the left sides are the your input interpretation, seismic swell logs and others on the right side, that is the data, and all these things are prior, and all these particular these three circles what you get, that is where is the Bayesian inference. You are integrating everything, all the prior informations are integrated to get the posterior. Then posterior probability density functions you sample, and each of these particular sample becomes a realization. And in fact, that is where all the methods vary. So there can be sequential Gaussian simulations, there can be Markov chain Monte Carlo. In fact, Markov chain Monte Carlo is one of the greatest innovations of the last century. If you simply Google Markov chain Monte Carlo, then you will find the best 10 algorithms which have been developed in the last century. One of them is Markov chain Monte Carlo. First Fourier transforms will be another, and there are many more, some of those you know quite well. So Markov chain Monte Carlo method is used by some of the softwares for this particular purposes. What are the benefits of geostatistical inversion? It gives you results at a very fine sample, means much more details. It quantifies uncertainty. Uncertainty quantifications is an integral part of geostatistical inversion, which is not available in deterministic inversion. In deterministic inversion, we first invert and then characterize uncertainty. Whereas in geostatistical inversion, uncertainty is an integral part because you are talking about multiple realizations. Some of the things which is there, I have low lighted because those are very software specific. I simply wanted to tell you that it can be done as a kind of a joint inversion. It can be done in stratigraphic grid, and you can directly even invert for the reservoir properties like volume of clay, porosity, and water situation. But that is not that important. That is more often algorithmic rather than scientific. More important part is that you have got multiple realizations of lithology, multiple realizations of acoustic impedance, multiple realizations of BPBS, and I have shown only three or four realizations. You will have got 50, 100, or even more, depending upon how many realizations you do. So what you can determine from that? You can determine statistics of that. Those statistics can be frequency of a gas sands, that can be what is the most frequent type in the, or most probable phases, and the probability as we are talking during the previous case. So in geostatistical inversions, you always do this as a part of that. In summary, the most important part to take is that this is a highly detailed, realistic 3D numerical model, but that high details beyond seismic bandwidth, which is brought by the geostatistics, does not come, I will say, freely. As Americans say, no free lunch, it is also there. Since you have got higher details, you need to think probability. You need to interpret in terms of the probability, and we are not, our mind is not tuned to think probability. We can think probability, but when we have to take a decision, interpretive decision on the basis of that, we really do not feel a lot of confidence. So this mindset need to change. There are more, as I said, that all those put in the blue are the points to be taken. These are constant to multiple sources of disparate input data, and it makes an objective quantification of uncertainty. There is much more to geostatistical inversion. I simply introduced this one. Now, next 5 minutes, we shall simply take a pictorial tour of seismic inversion, applications of seismic inversion. And I have put a list just to guide you. This is not a very comprehensive list, but then it is a list which will help you to understand what different kind of applications it has got. You can see from interpretation, it aids interpretation, risk assessment, reservoir mapping, sweet spots, and so many. You can read all these things later time. Let's look at this. This is a problem of interpretation. Look at the curve, which is yellow, and I want to interpret that particular layer and start tracking it either from the top or from the bottom and come in the middle part. Do you feel comfortable? Whether it will go low or it will go high, you have got uncertainty. You can see some reflections, so someone will be tend to put at the higher part, someone will tend to put in the lower part. If you take at the background the seismic inversion, then you can see that there is no ambiguity. So this was practically a channel cut. So you can very easily now fix out that where the interpretation will be. So this is an example where seismic inversions can help you. So this was a bypass well channel. So this is a case where seismic inversions can help in interpretation. Next, again, you can see that you have got on the right side, this blue, you can see a well over there. The blue curve is water saturation or resistivity. Higher water saturation means this is practically the hydrocarbon. The black one is gamma ray, it can be gamma ray or volume of clay. So that talks about the sand, and this sand is practically the blue one, shows that it is a gas sand. Now you can see a similar type of the amplitude on the left side, away from this particular, on the left side of the fault. The question is that whether it is a gas sand or it is not a gas sand. You are still in doubt, but if you do an inversion, then now you know that it is really a hydrocarbon sand. It has got the similar acoustic impedance. So again, the risk in this particular case gets a bit reduced because you could also support from seismic inversion. So easy interpretations of the patient. This is a case where you can see two things. One is there are two prospects. One is the shallow prospects, which is written upper layer, and one is the lower layer. And it was prognosed that it is the deeper layer or the lower layer, which is a much better, as you can see the amplitudes and others, and seismic attributes have been computed. And on the basis of the seismic attributes on the left side, you can see it was prognosed that lower sand is much better compared to the upper one, where upper one is very, very discrete. But when the well was drilled, it was found that it is not the lower one. On the right side, you can see that it is the upper one, which is a better well rather than the lower. Lower one was quite poor. And seismic inversion showed the same thing, that it is the upper sand, which is a much better developed compared to the lower one. What was the reason behind it? The reason was seismic tuning. Since you have already read interpretation, you might have already seen that when the thickness of the bed is lesser than the seismic resolution, lambda by 4, then there is an amplitude buildup. And that amplitude buildup for the lower sand has given a misinterpretation. And once we have done an inversion, the effect of the wave bed has been taken out, so that ambiguity has been reduced. So again, you can see that this is how it helps. It can help find out the sweet spot. You do inversion, so there was a structure. From the prognosis, it was first considered from the attributes that the entire structure has got hydrocarbon. But after seismic inversions, you can find it is not the entire structure which contains hydrocarbon, but hydrocarbons are only in a part of that. So OWC, practically there was a well water contact at a particular place. So beyond that lower side, there was no hydrocarbon at all. So seismic inversions clearly gives that. It gives reservoir geometry. On the left side, you can see RMS, root mean square, attribute of the full stack seismic data. You can see some of the bodies, but not very quite well developed. But on the right side, you take an inversion, and similar from the inversions, you compute the porosity, and these are the porosity attributes. So that gives quite a good developed. That means the seismic reservoir geometry is better delineated using that. Another example, you can see that how well you can delineate the different, how the channels are going, how the different bodies are there. So seismic inversion helps you quite a lot in this. Similar thing, reservoir connectivity. The top figure is from P impedance of deterministic inversion, the bottom one from the well sands. So you can find out that practically in this particular case, the sand was thin, and geostatical inversion gives much more information compared to the deterministic inversion. This is an example from India. In one of that, look at the left one, where the sand thickness maps were created on the basis of well information only. Away from the well, you have got nothing other than the seismic data. And that seismic data, if you convert into acoustic impedance, and acoustic impedance can be converted to porosity, once you do that, then the geometry of this particular body, that becomes much, it looks much more geological rather than this type of arbitrary things which have been put in the left figure. Similar examples. This is one of from US, quite a thin bed. You can see 20 feet. 20 feet means 7 meter. 7 meter to 10 meter can never be resolved by seismic or deterministic inversion. Whereas once geostatical inversion was done, you can find out the geology of the area, the point bar complex, the abundant channel, and like that. This is for limestone. I wanted to put it because when you come to industry, you will hear many of the time that inversion does not work over limestones or carbonates, but it will depend upon the situation. So in this case also, the sands in a pack of nearly 70 feet, which is there are individual porous units which are 3 to 5 meter thick each, and geostatical inversions can capture them. Another one, this is a very well-known publication in fast break. I shall give you the reference later. So even in carbonate reservoir, geostatical inversions can find out those particular thin sands. And this is another example. You see that lot many dry holes were drilled before seismic inversions were done. And once seismic inversions were done, then you know that where these sands are, where these particular, I don't remember whether it is sand or shale, but where these sweet spots are. So all those, what is that, hot colors, the red as well as the yellow, those are the hot colors which are showing the sweet spots over there. So geostatical inversion maps thin sands. This is another very, very good example from Indonesia. So if you do geostatical inversion, then go for interpretation using a 3D seed picking, a standard interpretation technique that gives you the entire reservoir geometry on the right side. You compute the reservoir thickness and know that where to put the new well. So here a new well was put over there, which was highly productive. So this is how it helps. So again, from the same field, you can see before seismic inversion was done, a long outreach well, means kind of a horizontal well, was planned, and this was the planning at the top. But when it was drilled, it was found that that particular layer was not so simple. It was going up and down, and then the drilling, that was there was chances of missing out, means there were chances of going up and down through the sands or entering the shale section. So geostatical inversion has proved that one, and now the entire thin reservoir has been very nicely delineated so that geosteering techniques can be applied easily for this particular well. So that is, I will say in a brief, I wanted to talk about in application of seismic inversion in subsurface reservoir characterizations for well and gas. I will formally thank you for your patient hearing. I know that there is some problem in between, but I hope for most of the part I was audible. Back to you, Ishika.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. It was a pleasure, and we all enjoyed your session today. Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much for joining the session.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone. Thank you for patient hearing, your attendance, sir. Everything.